Okay, I think we'll make a start now. Today I'm going to talk about transformation-induced plasticity and twinning-induced plasticity. And the big difference between these two is that here we have a phase transformation and a deformation, whereas in this case we have only a mechanical deformation. So here we can influence things very much by altering temperature or altering the alloying element composition. In this case, you will see that there are limits on how you can do alloy design. Now, the original TWIP steels, this is an example of a TWIP steel that you'll find in almost every car these days. So you know that the weight of a car has been increasing over the last 10 years, not decreasing, even though a lot of new steels are used in the manufacture of cars, the actual weight has been going up. Do you know why? Safety measures. And one of the safety measures is that you must have resistance to side impact. For you know, if a car hits you from the side, then you still should be reasonably safe inside the passenger compartment. And therefore, we have these bars which basically transmit the load to the structure and deform the structure while keeping you safe inside, hopefully. So if the weight is increasing, then we need stronger and stronger steels. And if you make steel stronger, generally the ductility decreases. Okay? One way of ensuring that you have ductility is to exploit transformation-induced plasticity, and we'll see how this increases ductility. The original TWIP steels were fully austenitic, so they had a chemical composition which is rich in nickel, you know, 38% of nickel, for example. The reason being that we want the Martin side start temperature to be well below room temperature. And when you apply a stress to this, you induce martensitic transformation, even though the transformation temperature is below that at which you apply stress. And what this micrograph shows is basically a sample of austenite polished completely flat and then allowed to transform into martensite, and you get a change in the surface relief, and that change in the surface relief is the transformation plasticity. It's the mechanical deformation due to the change in crystal structure. So it's a real deformation, you can see it with your eyes, and it has consequences on the properties of the material. Now obviously, you know, 38% of nickel is extremely expensive. But at first, I'm going to just talk about TWIP steels which are fully austenitic to begin with, not the normal TWIP steels that go into automobiles. Okay, so just to revise what we've done in a previous lecture, the transformation causes a deformation which is properly described as an invariant plane strain. That means it leaves one plane unrotated and undistorted. And for steels, the shear strain is of the order of 0.25, 0.26. And the volume change normal to the habit plane is approximately 3%, 0.03. And by choosing this particular frame of reference, where Z1 is on the invariant plane, Z2 is also on the invariant plane, and Z3 is the normal to the invariant plane, we can easily define our deformation matrix in the coordinate system Z. If we look at what happens to 100 due to deformation, there is no change. Similarly, 0010, which points out of the plane of the board, there's no change. And this particular vector here changes into a vector S0, 1 plus delta, because it acquires a component along the x-axis. So that's our deformation matrix. Once you have that deformation matrix, you can find out what happens to any vector as a consequence of this deformation. So here's the deformation matrix, and U is our initial vector, and V is what happens to that vector as a consequence of deformation. And I can simply obtain V by multiplying the deformation matrix by the vector U. And here's an example, supposing that U is 101 in the coordinate system Z. Then by multiplying this by 101, a column matrix which is 101, I get my vector v as 1.260, 1.03. So you have the direction and you have the magnitude of the vector which results from the deformation of u. And the elongation is given approximately by 1 minus the magnitude of v divided by the magnitude of u. And in this case, it's 14%. Now, why do I say this is approximate? Why is this elongation approximate? Well, remember, you know, this vector is also rotated, right? Now, if you're doing a tensile test, then you do not actually measure the rotation. You want to know what is the elongation in this direction u. In other words, you need to resolve the vector v along u to find the actual elongation, okay? But assuming that the rotation is small, the elongation is of the order of 14%, okay? So the vector u is not actually, in general, parallel to the vector u, and therefore you need to correct for that by projecting the magnitude of v along the direction u, if you want to measure the elongation along the direction u. Is everyone happy with that? Sometimes the rotation can be very large. It depends on what the vector v is. But of course, the magnitude of v indicates how much the vector u extended as a consequence of the deformation. Okay. Now, what we want to do is we want to induce the transformation by applying a stress. Okay. So I'm just going to explain to you very briefly how we calculate a Martensite start temperature. So imagine that we're plotting here the free energy of austenite and of ferrite as a function of temperature. Then at some point, the free energy of ferrite becomes smaller than that of austenite, and phase transformation becomes possible when you undercool below this temperature. Okay? However, you need to account for many things. We have a deformation, so there will be strain energy. You need to nucleate the martensite, etc. So transformation will not happen exactly at the point where the free energy of ferrite and austenite are equal. But you will need to undercool a certain amount before you get martensitic transformation. And that undercooling is given by this finite decrease in free energy, as opposed to the point where they have exactly the same free energy. So supposing I know the value of this, then by calculating this curve, I can simply read off the Martensite start temperature. Okay? Now, you can calculate this curve very easily these days using software packages, for example, empty data or thermocalc, which allows you to work out the free energy of austenite and the free energy of ferrite as a function of chemical composition, pressure, temperature. And you can even download programs free of charge, which will allow you to do that. So this curve is easy to calculate. All you need to know is this value here, and that gives you the Martensite start temperature. And I'll explain to you how to calculate this value in the last two lectures. Now, supposing you modify your composition, you add 1 weight % of manganese, then this curve would shift to a lower free energy change because manganese stabilizes austenite, and therefore your Martensite start temperature would be depressed. So this is very powerful. You've got software available these days which routinely allows you to calculate the free energy differences as a function of alloy composition, temperature, and so on. So here we are inducing Martensite by cooling until a critical value of driving force is achieved, and that is our Martensite start temperature. If I now apply a stress, then the stress will interact with the shape deformation of martensite and will add a mechanical free energy to this, which is a chemical free energy term. Okay. So let's say that the effect of the stress And it need not be just a tensile stress, it can be a pressure, it can be a triaxial, biaxial stress, whatever. That stress will interact with the shape deformation of martensite and add a certain free energy, U. So our original curve here, this is the curve with stress equal to zero for the chemical free energy change. That will be changed to this curve here by adding the mechanical free energy term, and therefore the original martensite start temperature will increase to what we call MS sigma over here. Okay? So the effect of the stress, assuming it's tensile stress and assuming we are dealing with steel, where we have a shear strain of 0.26 and a volume change of 0.03, the tensile stress will actually result in an increase in the martensite start temperature. What happens if I apply a hydrostatic pressure? Would that increase the MS or decrease the MS? Decrease, right? Because you're right. Very good. So pressure has no shear component, so the strain S becomes irrelevant. And delta is positive, the volume change is positive, it opposes the pressure, and therefore pressure would tend to decrease the martensite start temperature. Okay? So all we need to know now is how to calculate this mechanical free energy, and then we can design our TWIP steel to transform at a particular stress. Okay, here is an experiment in which we have not a parallel tensile specimen, a tensile specimen with a parallel gauge length, but we have a slight taper here. Okay, that means it's a conical, slightly conical shape. And that means that when I pull it, I will have a gradient of stress along the sample. Okay? So in a single experiment, you can look at the effect of stress on the amount of martensite that you get, and you can see here that for this particular alloy, which was tested at minus 44 degrees centigrade, which is above its MS temperature, you generate quite a lot of martensite simply by applying a stress. And in this case, the amount of martensite is proportional to the magnitude of the tensile stress. So a mechanical driving force is real because martensite has a shape deformation. It's just like slip, where if I apply a stress, then slip will happen. Similarly, if I apply a stress, martensite will form, assuming that the chemical driving force is significant, and the mechanical driving force added to that will bring it up to the amount required to generate martensite. But there is another consequence of stress. We have 24 possible orientations of martensite that can form when we cool austenite in each grain of austenite. 24 because, you know, if I take a general plane, like 1, 2, 3, then there are 24 variants of that plane. So similarly, the martensite habit plane will have 24 variants. So in each austenite grain, I can form 24 possible orientations of martensite. Some of those orientations will be favorably oriented relative to the stress, and others will oppose the stress. Okay? So we will no longer have a random microstructure. We will have a microstructure in which plates which are better oriented to the applied stress will grow more than those which oppose the stress. Okay? So we will generate a non-random structure. So if I show you an optical micrograph of this specimen, this is a polycrystalline sample of austenite with a grain size which is of the order of that. And we've applied a stress here, and you can see that the plates tend to be aligned at approximately 45 degrees to the applied stress, even though we have a polycrystalline sample. In other words, each grain is choosing a plate to grow which is approximately at 45 degrees to the applied stress. Okay? So this is a non-random structure which has grown under the influence of the applied stress. Now, why approximately 45 degrees? Yeah, that's the plane of maximum shear stress. And I say approximately because remember this is not simply a shear strain, there's also a volume change. Okay, so we'll work out that angle more accurately shortly. But this is exactly like the Schmid law, where you know you apply a stress and certain slip systems will be favored and others not favored. Okay? So the consequence of stress is not simply to induce martensite, but to induce certain types of martensite, which tend to reduce the stress. Okay? So that means they are favored by that stress. Okay, I want to now work out the value of U, the mechanical driving force. So, supposing that I'm just looking at an ordinary stress strain curve in the elastic region, then what is the strain energy per unit volume? Yeah, it's the area under that curve, isn't it? So, that area under the curve is simply this triangle, which is half stress times the elastic strain. And if I replace the stress by modulus times elastic modulus times strain, then U will be proportional to the elastic modulus and to the square of the elastic strain. Now, supposing that we replace elastic strain with plastic strain, then the factor of a half disappears because, look, if this is plastic strain, it's permanent, and this is the area under the curve, and that will be the strain energy per unit volume, sigma times the amount of plastic strain. And of course, when we form martensite, that's a plastic deformation. It's permanent. You can see it there, and it doesn't go away when we remove the stress, unless it's a shape memory alloy in which the martensite is reversible. Okay, but we are not referring to shape memory metals. We are referring to irreversible martensitic transformation, okay, which is the majority of that. So the term U will be equal to a stress times a strain, and there is no factor of a half. Okay, so the term U will be a stress times a strain, and in this case, it's a shear stress on the habit plane multiplied by the shear strain, so shear stress on this plane here, multiplied by the shear strain. And the normal stress on this plane, that means the stress pointing at 90 degrees to the invariant plane, multiplied by the volume change. So that's the mechanical free energy term. So all that remains is for us to calculate what tor is and what sigma n is given a certain tensile stress. So I've applied the tensile stress. I want to know what the shear stress on the habit plane is and what the normal stress on that plane is. Okay. Have you come across Mohr's circles at all? Yeah? Have you come across Mohr's circles? I will explain them to you very, very quickly. So a Mohr's circle allows you to calculate the shear stress and the normal stress on a plane whose normal is inclined at an angle 2 theta to the stress axis. Okay? So supposing I'm applying a stress sigma 1 here, okay? And this is the normal to this plane here. So that makes an angle of theta. Actually, that should be theta. And this is direction of shear, and for simplicity, the direction of shear, the normal to the plane, and the tensile axis are in the same plane, all right? In principle, this direction of shear can lie anywhere on that plane, but I'm simplifying it. So a Mohr circle is a plot of shear stress versus normal stress. And sigma 1 is the tensile stress that we've applied here. I plot the plane here at an angle 2 theta to the direction of the applied stress, and tor naught is the shear stress on the plane, and sigma n is the normal stress on the plane. Okay? So it's a very simple construction which allows you to work out the normal and shear stress on any plane. Of course, you can also use a strain tensor. Okay, so if you take a strain tensor, multiply it by a unit vector, you will get a stress vector, which when you resolve onto the plane, that gives you the shear stress, and when you resolve it normal to the plane, that gives you normal stress. Okay, but this is a diagrammatic way of solving the same problem. So from this diagram, the shear stress is simply, cos of 2 theta is this distance over this distance, isn't it? Yeah. And this distance here is sigma 1 divided by 2. Okay. So cos of 2 theta is equal to tau naught over sigma 1 upon 2. Yeah. Simple geometry gives you the shear stress. And this term here, this term here is, actually I should have said sine 2 theta, not cos. Okay? So tau naught, this distance here divided by this distance here is sine of 2 theta. And this distance here is, this distance divided by this distance is cos of 2 theta plus sigma 1 upon 2 will give us the normal stress. Okay, so here we are. This is the shear stress term. The radius of the Mohr circle multiplied by sine 2 theta multiplied by the shear strain gives us the mechanical driving force due to shear. And this is sigma 1 upon 2 plus sigma 1 upon 2 cos 2 theta to give us the normal stress multiplied by the normal strain. So what I want to find now is what is the maximum value of the mechanical driving force that I can get. So all I have to do is differentiate the top equation and set the differential to zero to find the value of theta, that means the inclination of the habit plane to the tensile stress, which will give me the maximum value of u. And if you do that, you'll find that that equation there, tangent to theta, is equal to the shear strain divided by delta. So we now know the orientation of the habit plane, which will give us the maximum interaction with the tensile stress. And therefore, we can calculate the greatest value of the mechanical free energy, and therefore the highest MS temperature possible. Okay, so in this equation here, where we work out the effect of the shape deformation on the vector u, we can substitute for the vector u the value of theta that we just calculated, theta max, okay? Because that will be the orientation of the habit plane. And when we go through the same calculation as we did previously to find the vector v, this is the amount of elongation that you will get if you take a 100% austenitic sample, okay, you pull it, and you form 100% of martensite in the best orientation possible. Okay? So this gives you the maximum possible elongation that you can get from transformation-induced plasticity, beginning with a fully austenitic sample and assuming that you only form martensite which is in the optimum orientation. You cannot get more than this elongation. Okay. So can you explain why even this might be an overestimate? In real life, this is likely to be an overestimate. Well, you know, we are not free to change the value of theta, are we? Martensite will form on particular planes, okay? So it will be the plane which is closest to the value of theta on which you will get martensite, but it will not be exactly the theta that we worked out to give us the maximum u. So in general, if you have 100% austenite and it transforms into 100% martensite, you are likely to get elongation less than 15%, okay? Now, this is the point that I was making. that look, if I have a set of austenite grains which have a random texture, okay, so these are austenite grains in a polycrystalline material, and for every single one of those grains, I work out a mechanical driving force for all 24 plates, and all 24 plates in the 1,000 austenite grains that I have, then I will have a distribution of mechanical free energy. It won't be a single value of mechanical free energy. Some of them will have a very small interaction, others will have a large interaction, and therefore the total amount of elongation that you pick up is likely to be a lot less than 15% due to transformation alone. Okay? Now, given this kind of a variation in mechanical free energy for a texture, if you have other kinds of texture in the austenite, then you get different distributions of mechanical free energy. So as soon as you apply a stress, every single martensite plate in your material will have a different MS temperature. Okay? Every single plate will have a different MS temperature because the value of U will be different for that. So if you have 24 plates per austenite grain and 1,000 grains of austenite, then there are actually 24,000 MS temperatures in your material. It's no longer a unique martensite start temperature because the stress adds a different value of U to each plate. Okay? So when we talk about TWIP steels, it doesn't make sense to say that, look, I have an MS temperature of this. It depends on which plate you're talking about. Okay, let's just skip this. Well, I won't skip it. Obviously, if you have a different martensite start temperature, then the plates with the higher martensite start temperature will have a larger fraction of martensite at any temperature. Okay, so you will tend to form certain orientations with large volume fraction and other orientations with much smaller volume fraction. So these are the plates which form last, which have a very, very small volume fraction because they are not favored. Okay, and these are the plates which form first, which have a large volume fraction. And therefore, there's not much austenite left to form plates which are not favored. Okay? Now, the consequence of this on the toughness of the material can be serious, because if you form only a few orientations of martensite, then a crack can propagate across those packets of martensite more easily than if you form 24 orientations inside a grain. So this kind of an effect should be bad for toughness, if you think about the toughness of martensite. Okay, let's go on. So this is to illustrate to you that when we form martensite under stress, you cannot think about a single MS temperature. So this is how martensitic transformation develops when there is no stress. That means as you get to the MS temperature, you get a sharp increase in the martensite volume fraction. Okay, and this is given by a particular law which I'll talk about in the next lecture. But if you have a whole range of martensite start temperatures, then this becomes gradual. Okay, so you can see the larger the stress, the greater the distribution in the martensite start temperature, and therefore the more gentle the evolution of martensite as a function of undercooling. Yeah. So, you know, when you do your dilatometry experiments and you find that the curve is not sharp like this, that is an indication that either you don't have a homogeneous, chemically homogeneous sample, so martensite is starting at different temperatures in different regions, or you have a temperature gradient in your sample, so that in some regions martensite can form because the temperature is lower than in other regions, or that there's a stress which is changing the martensite start temperature as a function of orientation. So curves like this, if you look carefully at your dilatometric data, you will see that curves like these are actually typical, because in a dilatometer, you cool by blowing gas onto the sample, right? That means there's a temperature gradient in the sample. And therefore, the martensite will start at different positions at different time periods during cooling. So if you use a high cooling rate, then the curve which looks like this. If you use a very slow cooling rate, assuming you don't get other transformation products, you will get a sharper curve. Okay, 30% nickel is too expensive to make TWIP steels. So a few decades ago, a very clever method was designed to make extremely cheap TWIP steels. And these are called TWIP-assisted steels because they are not fully austenitic. There's a small fraction of martensite, of austenite, which is of the order of 15%. And the whole concept relies on the fact that cementite here hates to have silicon in its lattice. Yeah? Now, the hate is so large that the equilibrium concentration of silicon in cementite is virtually zero. Okay. But if you form cementite at a low temperature, then silicon cannot diffuse, and therefore it is forced into the cementite lattice. And if the free energy change for that increase in concentration is too large, you know, it increases the free energy of the cementite by a great deal, then cementite will not form at all. Right? So silicon retards or prevents the precipitation of cementite from austenite. Now, of course, how do we know this? Because if you cannot dissolve silicon in cementite, then you can't do thermodynamic measurements. Well, you know this by doing first principles calculations, that if you take your cementite unit cell, remove an iron atom, and substitute that with a silicon atom, then there's a large increase in the free energy of austenite. So silicon, aluminium also, does not want to be inside the cementite lattice. So this is a beautiful example of a first principles calculation because you cannot do an experiment. Yeah? Solubility is so small that you cannot actually do a thermodynamic measurement. The only way to access that by first principles calculations, and then you put these data into thermodynamic databases which allow you to do calculations of phase diagrams and so forth. Non-equilibrium phase diagrams. So austenite is expensive, and the way in which we stabilize austenite and make it very cheap is using the bainite reaction. So here, bainite forms exactly like martensite, without any diffusion. But the carbon then escapes into the remaining austenite because bainite is forming at a relatively high temperature. And normally, it would precipitate as cementite. Okay? That is our upper bainite structure. But if we add silicon, then the reaction stops here. And we end up with carbon-enriched retained austenite and almost carbon-free bainitic ferrite. Now, there is nothing more cheap for producing austenite than carbon. Yeah? And furthermore, the carbon is being used in a very clever way. We are removing it from the ferrite and putting it into the austenite, and therefore the average carbon concentration of your steel can be very low. And that's important because you need to weld steels, right? So you need to ensure that during spot welding and so on, you don't get martensite created, which is brittle. So we are using a low average carbon concentration, and by making the carbon partition into the austenite, you are stabilizing that austenite with a very high carbon concentration of the order of 1.2 weight percent. Okay, so even if your average is 0.15, in the steel, the austenite will have a much larger carbon concentration. And this is a typical structure. In addition to the bainite, at higher temperatures, we generate allotriomorphic ferrite. The bainite is inside these regions, which are now left as austenite. And the steel is designed so that under the influence of stress, you will get martensitic transformation that retained austenite, and that's why it's a TWIP steel. TWIP assisted because the fraction of austenite is quite small, of the order of 0.2. So it's only when this kind of a structure was invented that TWIP steels became usable. because, you know, having 30% nickel is just unacceptable in terms of cost. Okay, before I move on, so we have a problem here that if we had a completely austenitic sample, then the maximum elongation we could get is 15%. Okay. Now, supposing that we only have 20% of austenite, what is the maximum elongation you could get? Yeah? It'll be 15% multiplied by 0.2, which is how much? Come on. 15 times 0.2 is how much? 3%, right? So, in a trip-assisted steel, the maximum elongation that you can get from martensitic transformation is 3%. That doesn't seem reasonable because trip steels have a lot of elongation, right? So what is the conclusion? The martensite formation during trip can only add at most 3% of elongation, right? Assuming that, you know, the plates form at the correct orientation. In reality, it'll be less than 3%. So why are trip steels so ductile? You know, typically you can get elongation of 20%. Very good. So it isn't the elongation due to the shape deformation that is making much of a difference, but the austenite transforming into hard martensite gives you work hardening, right? And work hardening stops plastic instabilities, and therefore you get extra elongation because you delay the onset of necking. Okay? So although we emphasize that they are trip steels, the purpose of the trip here is to increase the work hardening coefficient by replacing austenite by hard martensite. Okay? There is another consequence of the shape deformation, which is that it introduces dislocations into the surroundings. So that gives you continuous yielding instead of discontinuous yielding. Continuous yielding is important in formability to avoid Luder strains. Right. So the maximum elongation that we can get from trip steels, trip assisted steels, is of the order of 3% from transformation alone. And that's because, you know, the shear strain associated with martensite is 0.26. Now, twinning is another possibility. And twinning actually has much larger shear strain than martensite. The shear strain associated with twinning is 1 over square root of 2, which is 0.7071, compared with a quarter for martensite. So these are the so-called TWIP steels, which you've heard of a lot, where when you apply a stress, you get mechanical twinning in austenite, assuming that the stacking fault energy is such that you prevent martensitic transformation, and the stacking fault energy is not so high that you only get slip deformation. Right? So choose the composition carefully. Mechanical twinning is the preferred mode of deformation. Now, twinning is basically a reflection of the crystal about the twin plane. The twin plane is the invariant plane. So you can see that this is a, like a reflection about this plane. This point here goes to that point, this one to that one, and so on. Okay. And in the case of austenite, the twin plane is a closed back plane, a 1-1-1 plane. So just like martensite, we have a deformation system where the twin plane is the invariant plane and the twinning direction inside that plane is the shear direction. There is no volume change in twinning. And the crystal structure here is exactly the same as the crystal structure here. So there's no change in crystal structure. There's no phase transformation. So the closed back planes are stacked in a sequence ABC, ABC, ABC. And what we have to do is this plane, which is located on A sites, we pass a dislocation so that it changes into B sites, so that B is a reflection across this twin plane. Okay. So what we've got to do is change the locations of the atoms from one side to the other on every successive plane. So here, for example, A changes to B, so B is a reflection about this twin plane C. And that distance, the movement which changes the stacking sequence, is one of these vectors going from, say, a C-type site to a B-type site here. Okay. The ABC simply refers to the positions of successive planes. Now, this vector here is not a lattice vector. In other words, if I translate a layer by that vector, then the stacking sequence will change. This vector here is a lattice vector. If I go from a C site to a C site, there's no change. Okay? And this distance here is an A6, 112 type distance. And therefore, the magnitude of the shear is A over root 6, which is the magnitude of 1/6, 112, this distance here. And this shear has to happen on every plane. So if I divide by the spacing of those planes, which is A over root 3, then that gives me the magnitude of the shear strain. So it's very large, okay, very large. But again, if you do a calculation of the contribution of twinning, assuming that all of the austenite twins into the optimum orientation of the twin when you apply a stress, then you'll find that the total elongation you get from twinning, assuming all of the austenite twins, is actually quite small. It's about 40%. But you know that the fraction of twinning that happens during the deformation of a TWIP steel is much less than 100%. So the total contribution of twinning to elongation is quite small compared with the 100% elongation that you get in a TWIP steel. So what is the mechanism of getting lots of elongation? It's exactly the same, that we get work hardening, because the formation of twins reduces the size of the remaining austenite, and that makes it more difficult to get deformation in the smaller and smaller and smaller regions of austenite. Okay? So it's the work hardening mechanism due to twinning that gives you the large elongation. Now, I'm finally going to show you an application which you probably haven't thought about because we don't mention it in GIFT, and this is in the context of welding. You know, when we make large structures, they have to be joined together by welding. Welding means you pour some liquid metal between two pieces of metal. When that liquid solidifies, you've got a joint. But the consequence is that when it solidifies, you get contraction. And you've got a large structure which can't move. So when you get that contraction, you already have a stress system built into your component. And that's bad, because you really want to design the structure to take an external load, not have residual stresses inside the material. So welding is very useful for making structures, but it's actually almost like a defect. Introducing a weld gives you a complex state of stress in the location of the joint, and it applies to, you know, offshore structures which undergo severe conditions. This is a line pipe in the Cheyenne Plains in Canada. We are actually working on this particular material, and every segment here is joined by welding. These are welding stations, and you can see the bits and pieces of pipelines over there. So that will introduce stresses into your pipe and make it more susceptible to corrosion in that area, or it will limit the engineering stresses that you can apply by putting high pressure inside the pipe and so on. So is there a way in which we can compensate for the thermal contraction that occurs during welding? Okay. There was a beautiful experiment done back in the 1970s by Olbry and Jones. So they took a tensile specimen. Okay. heated it up to 1200 degrees centigrade and held it rigidly, right? So that when it cools, the grips are not moving. Okay. So obviously you get thermal contraction, and if it is fully austenitic, then you get a line here which gives you the stress that builds up in the tensile specimen. Now suppose that instead of a fully austenitic specimen, that means an austenitic stainless steel, we replace that with something which undergoes a phase transformation. So in this case it's a bainite transformation, then it basically follows the same behavior until transformation happens. And the stress from the thermal contraction favors the growth of variants of plates of bainite, which cancel out the stress. And therefore you get a reduction. At this point, all of the transformation is finished, so again you get a rise in stress. Okay? So you could actually exploit transformation plasticity to cancel out the stresses due to thermal contraction. But this is no good, because the transformation was exhausted here, and therefore you got a rapid rise in residual stress as the sample continued to cool. This is now a sample which undergoes martensitic transformation at a lower temperature, and you can see that we end up with a lower stress. So supposing you could design a steel where this temperature is the room temperature. Okay? That means you reduce the martensite start temperature so much that basically it's only exhausted, that means you've completed martensite, when you get to room temperature, then you will cancel out the effects of thermal contraction. So you need to design a welding alloy which will be such that its transformation plasticity cancels out the consequences of thermal contraction. Okay, now the problem with welding alloys is that you cannot just design one thing. Yeah? You have to make sure that the toughness is fine, the fatigue properties are fine, the corrosion resistance is fine, and so on. So it's very complicated. You can't simply reduce the martensite start temperature. So there is a whole science in optimizing a large number of parameters. I can't go into that today, but you need to design alloys very carefully, because welds are like defects, and that is where failure will happen usually. So it's not a simple problem of just reducing the martensite start temperature, but I'm going to show you some results. This is a commercial welding alloy which is not designed for transformation plasticity, and these are three alloys where by using alloying additions we reduce the martensite start temperature and we control a whole range of other properties which are absolutely essential for welding. Now the Albury and Jones experiments were done very simply. We have a tensile specimen heated to 1200 degrees centigrade and then held rigidly. You can do the experiments in a much more complicated way in a synchrotron, okay, costing much more money because there are lots of buttons and so on. But the point is that you can monitor the transformation as it happens, and you can have many different pieces of information from the diffraction data. So these are exactly the same kinds of experiments that Albury and Jones did, but on those three alloys that were designed for this purpose. And you can get a lot of information. You can actually measure the phase fractions as the transformation happens, the lattice parameters, the chemical compositions, and so on. And what you can see here is that the purple line here, this line, is the commercial material which is not designed for this but has a high transformation temperature. When you lower the transformation temperature, you end up with a state of stress which is more or less zero. Okay? Now, of course, in the case of welding alloys, you can add quite a lot of alloying elements because the amount of material that you use is quite small. So here we have 8.5 nickel, 14 nickel, and so on. It's much more important to get the right properties than worry about the expense of adding nickel or chromium, etc. If you make a weld that is not going to give you trouble, that's far more cost effective than trying to save on alloying additions. Now, another problem is when we make welds in stainless steels. Stainless steels are usually used in environments where there is severe corrosion, okay? Where there is potential for severe corrosion. If you make a weld with residual stress, again, you will have difficulties. So in the case of stainless steels, the only way we can get transformation plasticity is a martensitic stainless steel. Okay? But it would have to have a very low carbon concentration because chromium has a strong affinity for carbon and we don't want chromium carbides forming. Okay? Now, one consequence of designing a transformation-induced plasticity weld is to cancel out residual stresses, but another consequence is you reduce distortion. So when you join two things up and apply heat locally, it will change shape, the shape of the component. So if you're making a big ship, for example, and you put joints, then the plates will start to buckle at various points. That, of course, is not acceptable. Yeah? So if you cancel out residual stresses, you will also reduce distortion. And this shows you. So these are two plates of austenitic stainless steels welded, in this case, with a fully austenitic weld metal. That means it doesn't transform. And you can see the distortion here is of 7 degrees. By choosing an alloy which cancels out residual stresses, you dramatically reduce the amount of distortion. Okay? So residual stress and distortion controlled by exploiting transformation plasticity. So this is the whole area of TWIP steels in particular, and TWIP steels, goes well beyond automotive steels. There are many, many applications outside of the field of automotive steels. And they are making a big impact on real life in the construction of difficult structures, okay, large structures. So it's an area which is a growth area, and it's very, very dependent on the level of metallurgy and crystallography that you learn. So I've just given you a few examples of this, but we are now working, for example, on structures under the ocean, deep under the ocean, okay? Because, you know, we no longer can make oil rigs which will be attached to the floor of the sea because the sea that we are trying to exploit is much deeper than before. So instead, you build structures on the seabed. And again, you know, you cannot replace a component if it goes wrong. You've got to make your welds and materials compatible and able to last for 40 years or more. Okay? Okay, so I've got two more lectures and I'm going to show you one of the most spectacular theories in all of metallurgy in these last two lectures. Okay? So don't miss them. Thank you.